Welcome to the National Press Club, the world's leading professional organization for journalists. I'm Michael Freedman, the 113th president of the National Press Club. I'm the former general manager of CBS Radio Network, now journalist in residence at University of Maryland Global Campus, and executive producer of the Kalb Report, public broadcasting series moderated by journalist Marvin Kalb. We thank you for joining us tonight for this special virtual headliner event. On September 2, 1945, 75 years ago today, Japan formally surrendered to the Allied forces aboard the battleship USS Missouri in Tokyo Bay, marking the end of World War II. We're joining forces this evening with the National Press Club's American Legion Post 20 to salute all who served in World War II, including Post 20 member, retired U.S. Navy Captain Jack Crawford, now 100 years old, who barely escaped with his life at the Battle of Midway when the aircraft carrier USS Yorktown was crippled in the Japanese attack and later sank. During the past few months, the National Press Club has been pleased to mark the major anniversaries of this momentous year in World War II history. We've written in the NPC Wire the story about the death of the beloved war correspondent Ernie Pyle in combat on an island off Okinawa. We wrote about VE Day, Victory in Europe, on May 8. We offered a multimedia program marking VJ Day on August 14 when President Truman announced that Japan had accepted our terms to end hostilities. Former CBS News anchor Dan Rather was with us a few weeks ago to share the role of Edward R. Murrow and the Murrow Boys in creating broadcast news on radio during the war. Author Paul Dixon talked with us about his book on the creation of the GI Army that fought the war. Author Leslie M.M. Bloom joined us to discuss her book on how reporter John Hersey revealed to the world 1 year after the war the terrible carnage of the atomic bombs. All of these can be found on the club's website at press.org. Even before Pearl Harbor, the National Press Club had been a forum for speakers on what was transpiring around the world. On the day of the attack on Pearl Harbor, reporters congregated in the club to learn details and swap information. During the war, club leaders stood up against censorship and convinced the military and government they needed open information to support the war effort. And on VJ Day, the celebration swept by the National Press building and up into the club, even as reporters crammed to finish their stories on deadline. Also during the war, the club's American Legion Post, which had been created in 1919, the year after the end of World War I, hosted a series of so-called canteens beginning in 1943 that drew soldiers, Marines, and sailors from across the region on Saturdays for free hot dogs and beer. Soon these attracted top government and political figures as well as entertainers. One of those canteens, on February 10, 1945, drew the new Vice President of the United States, Harry Truman, and the young model and movie actress, Lauren Bacall. Mr. Truman, an accomplished pianist, played an upright piano for the troops. Bacall's agent saw an opportunity and urged the 20-year-old actress to climb atop the piano, draping her legs over it and looking down at Harry Truman. That photo has become the most famous ever taken at the National Press Club. Joining us this evening is someone who knows a lot about that photo and everything else about Harry Truman, along with his wife Bess and the events surrounding the end of the war. He is Clifton Truman Daniel, Harry and Bess's oldest grandson, and the son of Margaret Truman and her husband, the legendary former New York Times managing editor E. Clifton Daniel, Jr. Mr. Daniel is the honorary chairman of the Board of Trustees of the Harry S. Truman Presidential Library and Museum, and the author of two books about his grandparents. He is a frequent speaker and has portrayed Harry Truman on stage. Mr. Daniel joins us from his home in Chicago. We're also very pleased to have with us this evening Dr. Kurt Graham, director of the Truman Presidential Library and Museum in Independence, Missouri. Gentlemen, thank you both for joining us this evening.
Thank you.
We will accept questions from our online audience. I'll ask as many as time permits. To submit a question, please email Q&A@press.org. So let's get started with some questions for you, and we have a lot of them coming in from our members. Clifton Truman Daniel, you were 15 years old when your grandfather passed. What was it like growing up as the grandson of President Harry Truman?
off the top of my head, I don't have anything to compare it to, but my parents and my grandparents tried very hard to keep our lives normal. I didn't find out that my grandfather was president of the United States at home. I found out in school. My parents had not told me. The family joke being, thank God it was first grade and not high school. I went to school one morning in first grade, I think the first day of first grade, and the teacher asked me, wasn't your grandfather president of the United States? And I said, I don't know, news to me, I'll go home and check. And my mother told this story almost to her dying day. I came home that afternoon from school, I dropped my book bag at the front door and I marched across the living room and I stood in front of her and put my hands on my hips and said, Mom, did you know that Grandpa Truman had been president of the United States? And my mother put down her book and looked at me and said, yes, but just remember something. Any little boy's grandfather can be president. Don't let it go to your head.
You know, that's a wonderful story. And I recall from your saying it also, Casey Murrow, who is an honorary member of the National Press Club and the son of Edward R. Murrow, replicated many of the comments that you just said in talking about his father, Edward R. Murrow, and said he had a very normal upbringing and actually was also told, in essence, not to let the fact that his father was Ed Murrow go to his head. And very, very similar stories. Most people remember Harry Truman as the 33rd president of the United States upon the death of Franklin Delano Roosevelt, after having been a vice president for only 3 months. Of course, he's known for seeing America through the final stage and the end of World War II, and then helping rebuild the Western European economy with the Marshall Plan. Perhaps a little less known were his early years. So I'm not sure whether you want to take this question or Dr. Kurt Graham about his early years growing up on a farm, working at several jobs, and then serving in the Army in World War I. Gentlemen, I leave it to you.
Kurt, go ahead. I've had a question already.
Okay, well, I think that the interesting thing about Harry Truman for the context of this conversation is that he was extraordinarily ordinary in his background and in his upbringing. I mean, this man was a farmer from Missouri. You can't get much more heartland, much more American, much more sort of salt of the earth kind of people than what the Trumans were. He didn't have any privilege. He didn't have a trust fund. He couldn't even afford to go to college. And so he was very much an everyman, very much like a lot of people in the country, the majority of people in the country, I suppose. And that his story is one of not so much a meteoric rise as it is just a slow and steady plodding up the chain. And one responsibility led to another, which led to another. And, you know, he went from county commissioner to senator to vice president to president in the course of just a little over a decade. That would not happen today. It's a very unusual story in that sense. So Harry Truman's background as a Missourian, as a farmer, as a studious young man, because of his nearsightedness, he could not get out and play sports like all the other boys, and he would have loved to have done. But so he played the piano and he read books. And he became a different kind of person than he might have had he not had that particular challenge.
And how about his service in World War I?
Okay, I'll go ahead. He had joined the National Guard, I think 1905 originally, and then 1905, 1906, and then quit because he was working on his family's farm and courting my grandmother at the same time, but mostly he had a lot on his plate. So he quit the Guard until the United States entered World War I, and then he rejoined and went for basic training in Oklahoma as a lieutenant, elected lieutenant of a battery, I think Battery F, simply because he had recruited the most new members for the battery. And in those days, you could elect your officers. He was promoted to captain eventually, and served overseas in France starting in, they went over there in the spring of 1918, and I think he first saw action in September of 1918 in the Vosges Mountains. Mm-hmm. But that was for Grandpa, that was the first time that he knew he could lead men. He inherited the notorious Battery D, all of them well-educated Irish Catholics, Irish and German Catholics from Kansas City, smart people, but just with a healthy distaste for authority and a love of good drink. He whipped them into shape primarily by enforcing the rules their previous officers had not. And if they stepped out of line, he busted them in rank, which cost them money, and straightened them out. They became, at least in his estimation, the best battery.
Let's fast forward.
It's also significant to...
Go ahead. Go ahead, please.
I just wanted to mention that there were four presidents who served in World War I. Harry Truman is the only one who saw combat. Franklin Roosevelt was there, Assistant Secretary of the Navy. Hoover, Eisenhower, they all had jobs related to World War I, but Harry Truman was the only one. He went to France, took training on how to fire a French 75, and by golly, got the chance to do just that in the hills of France, and never lost a man in his under his command. So very significant moment in Harry Truman's, he didn't have to go, he was in his early 30s. He said he was not going to miss out on the most important thing in history up to that point, in his estimation. And he went there when he didn't have to. He was too old to be drafted, but he volunteered and he went there and he served. And he would not have become the president had he not had that experience, very clearly.
I'm going to jump to some questions that we have from our press club members. Clifton, we'll toss this one to you. Shortly after assuming the presidency, on April 12, 1945, your grandfather was briefed on a new highly destructive weapon the U.S. had developed, the atomic bomb. 4 months later, as U.S. forces were preparing to invade Japan, he made the fateful decision to drop the bombs on Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Historians have debated the merits of that decision over the years. President Truman famously had the "Buck Stops Here" sign on his desk and took full responsibility for the bombings. We're going to talk in a few minutes about your trip to Japan in 2012. Could you give us your thoughts on your views of that terribly difficult decision that he had to make at that time?
He always said, people sometimes ask me if I, all through my life, they've asked if I have any special insight into his mindset in making that decision, just by dint of being his grandchild and being around him. I don't. He and I never spoke about the bombings. As you said, I was 15 years old when he died, and that's a tough subject. He always said, I don't think that if I had asked him that he would have given me any answer differently from to you or to Kurt. He would not have given a different answer to me than he would to anybody else. He always said, in private and in public, that he made that decision to end the war as quickly as possible and save American and Japanese lives. That said, it was, I can't say that the decision haunted him, but he was fully aware of the destruction and damage and loss of life that it caused. And he did take full responsibility for that. He once met Colonel Paul Tibbets, who flew the Enola Gay, which dropped the first bomb on Hiroshima, and asked Tibbets if Tibbets had had any, if anybody had taken him to task for using that weapon, if anybody was giving him a hard time about it. And Tibbets said, no, they haven't really. And my grandfather said, well, if they do, you tell them that it was my decision, my responsibility.
You visited Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 2012. Talk about how that came about, what it was like to visit those cities where there had been so much death and destruction, and your thoughts since that time.
It came about when my son Wesley was 10 years old. He came home from school with a book, Sadako and the Thousand Paper Cranes. For those in the audience who don't know the story, Sasako Sasaki was a real little girl who survived the bombing of Hiroshima with her family. She was 2 years old, and they escaped relatively unscathed, but Sadako was diagnosed with radiation-induced leukemia 9 years later. In an effort to help in her own treatment, she followed a Japanese tradition that says if you fold 1,000 origami paper cranes you are granted health or a long life. The crane is a symbol of life in Japan. Sadako folded 1,300 cranes, but she died of the leukemia in 1955 at age 12. There is a monument to Sadako and to all of the children who were killed or wounded or sickened by the bomb that stands in Hiroshima's Peace Park, Peace Memorial Park today. It was one of the first monuments. I remember telling Wesley that it was important for him not only to understand his great-grandfather's decision and his country's point of view, but also to understand what that cost the Japanese citizens of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. His teacher, Rosemary Barilla, didn't just give them the book. She taught them Japanese history. She taught them culture. She took them to a Japanese restaurant. They folded cranes in class. They had a tea ceremony. I came home one afternoon from work and found Wesley in the living room wearing a kimono with green tea and sushi spread out on the coffee table behind him. Wesley sort of brought all of Japan into our lives. Well, I told that story to a visiting Japanese journalist, and the story, of course, was read in Japan. And out of the blue one day in 2005, I had a call from Masahiro Sasaki, Sadako's older brother, also a survivor of the bombing. And he asked simply if he said he'd heard that my son and I had read his sister's story and could we meet someday? And I said, yes. We met 5 years later in 2010, in May of 2010, at the 9/11 Tribute Museum in New York City, where Masahiro and his son Yuji were donating one of Sadako's last original cranes to the museum as a gesture of healing in the wake of the 9/11 attacks. And near the end of that meeting, Yuji Sasaki took a tiny paper crane out of a box and dropped it into my palm and said, that's the last crane that Sadako folded before she died. And at that point, he and his father asked me if I and my family would come to the memorial ceremonies in Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And as you said, we went in 2012, we attended both ceremonies, Hiroshima and Nagasaki. And between those ceremonies, we sat down with and listened to more than 24 survivors. None of them, not one of them came in anger or recrimination. They simply wanted to tell their stories in the hope that I would help keep telling those stories so that we all understand the horror of a nuclear attack in the hope that we don't do it again.
Kirk Graham, you're director of the Truman Presidential Library and Museum, which is located in Independence, Missouri, President Truman's hometown. You've been there since 2015. You've had a distinguished career leading museums and were a professor of history at California State University at San Bernardino. Perhaps it's important for younger generations to place what happened with the bombings of Hiroshima and Nagasaki in context. We'd been in a global battle for 4 years. The country was weary of the war. Everybody lost family and friends in the war. And I wonder if you could help us understand how we can put this into context for people who just hear that these bombs were dropped and all these people were killed and suffered horrible injuries as a result, but who have a difficult time putting it into context. Can you help us there?
Well, sure. The whole purpose of our museum is to provide the very context that you're talking about. I mean, we're undergoing a major renovation right now, be done in the next couple of months. And the whole purpose there is to help people understand the crisis that the world was in 1945 and how this farmer from Missouri had been sort of put in a position to suddenly have to make these huge decisions. And you've already mentioned the two things that people know about Harry Truman. They know that he had a buck stops here sign on his desk, and they know that he dropped the bombs. Beyond that, we don't assume anything. But the amazing thing is, when those bombs were dropped and the war was ended, this is in August of 1945. Of course, he's only been president since April. He still has 7.5 years to go of being president. So the real accomplishments and the real legacy of Harry Truman are post-war, not in this one single decision. Now, there's no way around that decision, But the context that we try to provide for young people is not to, we don't celebrate the dropping of the bombs. We don't apologize for the dropping of the bombs. We don't try to dismiss it in any way. We have a wonderful treatment of this in that the paper crane that Clifton just mentioned, that Masahiro came to the library shortly after I came here with Clifton, and they presented this to us as a gift. One of the last cranes that she folded that is now in our collection. And that will be juxtaposed in, right next to the safety plug in the bomb that went off over Nagasaki, which was also given to us many years ago. An airman, you know, went through the protocols, pulled out the safety plug, put in the activation plug, and just probably had it in his pocket. And years later, called the Truman Library and said, gee, I have this thing. Would you be interested? And this thing that he has is a safety plug. It's just a couple of inches long, and it is literally the trigger of the atomic age. It has the fingerprints of a U.S. airman on it. I mean, if you want, you can't get any closer to the birth of nuclear war, the birth of the atomic age, than that trigger, than that plug. And we have chosen to put that plug, which ended the war, right next to the crane that is the symbol of peace that grows out of that. And we hope that young people in particular, and all visitors, will come to appreciate what Harry Truman was facing. He was not a warmonger. He was not eager to kill people. He was not eager to see death and destruction. He wanted peace. He wanted the end of war. He said once famously, not just in our time, but in all time. He wanted to bring it to an end. And the only way he had to do that was to make that very horrific decision, which he made that summer after he had been told of the Manhattan Project and what he had available to him. But your question is well taken. It is very important for people to understand the context of that. This wasn't something Harry Truman dreamed up or thought this would be a good idea or cement him in our history books in some way. This was something he came to very soberly and very carefully, but I think he came to the conclusion that it had to be done. And once he made that decision, he moved on, and that's part of the message we want young people to understand as well. Life is full of decisions, sometimes very hard decisions. And I think Harry Truman is a great model of how to make decisions.
You mentioned, and I appreciate this, his many accomplishments in the post-war years. The Marshall Plan, the establishment of NATO, the Truman Doctrine, the Berlin Airlift, the recognition of Israel as a state, the racial integration of the military, to name just a few. I'd like to ask both of you, and Clifton, let me turn to you first. Do you see certain things as the most significant achievements? And how do you see his legacy? He really accomplished a lot in his time as president.
He did, Mike. And when I get the question, the answer I usually give when people ask what are his most significant accomplishments, there were so many, as Kurt has said, and you've said, he is responsible for the way the world looks today, for the post-war world, for rebuilding Europe. So the shape of global society is in great part due to my grandfather and his administration, to General Marshall and to Dean Acheson and all the folks who worked with him. But when I'm asked what I think his greatest accomplishment is, it might be a cop-out, but I always say that I always thought the greatest thing was that he showed this country that a farmer, a soldier, a small businessman can rise to the highest office in the land and do a better job of it than almost anybody else. A plain, straightforward, you said it at the outset, a straightforward Missourian, a Midwesterner, is regarded as one of our best presidents. And I think that's the promise of this country.
Terrific. Kurt, do you want to add anything to that?
Well, I would just say as he developed that post-war order that you've laid out very nicely, I would just mention two of those things, the recognition of Israel and the desegregation of the troops and of the federal workforce, both of which happened in, well, Israel in May of 48 and deseg in July of 48. Now, remember, he has to face re-election in the fall of 48, the whistle-stop campaign. Now, this is back when elections lasted 2.5 months and not 2.5 years. But nevertheless, he had to face the electorate. And he made these two, I think, really tough calls. And to me, I point to those things often because I think they indicate the fact that his decision making was always principle driven, principle centered. He could have easily ducked either one of those issues. He had lots of pressure within his administration, but it simply wasn't the right thing to do. When he spoke about both those topics, even in later years, he said, we needed an American solution. And the American solution was to do the right thing for people who had been oppressed, for people who had been injured or cheated or whatever, you know, kept down in some way. Harry Truman knew something about that. You know, he had to earn the respect of people in government, because he didn't just show up automatically from Missouri with the dirt under his fingernails and have people say, oh, wow, isn't this great? We have a new senator. I mean, he had to claw his way to the top, and he had to earn their respect. And I think he wanted to extend that opportunity to all peoples everywhere. So to me, when he said to the NAACP that he wanted to extend rights and privileges to all Americans, and he paused very dramatically and said, when I say all Americans, I mean all Americans. And everybody knew exactly what he meant. And I think, to go back to Clifton's answer, you know, a lot of people came forward at the time and said, well, you know, what's the big deal? Roosevelt's always talked about this kind of stuff. I mean, yeah, civil rights, whatever. And everybody said, no, Truman means it. And they knew that the world was about to change. And it did.
You touched on
and
something.
And just, Mike, if I just to add to that briefly, I think it pays to remember that Grandpa did, at least when it comes to the recognition of the military, he went against his own childhood, his own upbringing. He was born into and raised in a Confederate-leaning, fairly racist household, and was guilty himself of using racial epithets, he and my grandmother both. But he overcame that. He learned, he grew in office. And we have to remember that our leaders are human, like the rest of us. And Grandpa was able to overcome that and do what was the right thing.
Kurt, you mentioned something I'd like to delve a little deeper into. Of course, many of the things that he is remembered for, among them, that amazing come-from-behind victory over Thomas Dewey in the 1948 election. One of the remarkable aspects of that campaign, and you just mentioned it, was his whistle stops as he crisscrossed the country by train, making speeches from the rear platform of an observation car. I'd like to ask both of you, what do you see as the key reasons why he was able to win that election? Kurt, you started to touch on that before. Talk a little bit more about that.
Well, I mean, he goes out and communicates directly with the people. And especially in the Midwest, especially in farm states, I mean, who better to carry a message to farmers than a farmer? And I think Truman just built that momentum. He just went, sometimes he would do a dozen of these stops in a single day. You know, they would just go from town to town to town. And as they did that, you know, he had just a stump speech basically, but he would modify it depending on the town that he was in. He would say something nice about the local area or about the leaders. And sometimes he would stop and have lunch with them or whatever, but he never took it for granted. And he never stopped taking risks. There was a time when he was in Texas and he went to the dais. He went out into the town to give a speech. He's up on the podium, on the platform, and he shook hands with an African-American woman. And the crowd booed him. And he turned on him and he said, she has as much right to be up here as you do. And I think that's incredible when you think about what he was up against. He was in the fight of his life. Nobody thought Truman was going to win. In fact, the journalists traveling with him, there were 50 or so reporters, and they all said, you know, nice guy, Harry, but not a chance, not a chance. He's just not going to win. And they stopped taking polls, and nobody knew what was going to happen. But he sat down and guessed how each state was going to go with the Electoral College, and he didn't miss it by much. He knew exactly how people were going to respond to him, and that's exactly what they did.
Clifton, would you like to add anything to that?
Again, just a plain spoken, he's a good politician, but he genuinely liked people. I mean, mm-hmm. he was a joiner. He not only a Mason, but he joined other fraternal organizations. He uh, He loved being around other people. He loved what he did. And that came through. He got into politics solely to make things better. He often said that anybody who thinks he's going to go into politics to make money has to be a crook. There's no other way to do it. So he went in straight and went in honest and went in to do the right thing. But he loved the work. And that whistle stop campaign, if you look at the map at the Truman Library, it looks like they've let a three-year-old loose with a box of crayons. The crisscrossing lines, the rail lines he used, it covers the whole map practically. It would have worn anybody out, but Grandpa was actually energized by that. He loved the fight. And as Kurt said, he may have been the only one who thought he could win, but he was right. Well, except for my mother and my grandmother, they thought so too.
And of course, those of us who teach journalism for decades have been using as an example of why journalists have to be very careful about what they put on the front page of their newspaper. We have used as the classic example the early edition of the Chicago Tribune that says across the front page, "Dewey defeats Truman." And from the fabulous photo of your grandfather holding up that newspaper after he won, he obviously was pretty pleased with the outcome of that.
He was, and I just as a quick aside, I knew years ago, he's gone now, unfortunately, a Chicago Tribune reporter named Bob Weidrich. And Bob was a young reporter on election night in 1948. And Colonel McCormick sent those 10,000 or so papers out into the streets, and then the tide turned, and he grabbed every living, breathing Trib employee he could find and sent them back out to get those damn papers back here. And Weidrich, on his way home, Bob saw, he witnessed a fight between a Trib driver and a newsstand owner who knew what he had a hold of, and the newsstand owner won, yanked the papers back in his stall and locked the door.
Clifton Truman Daniel, you are an author and an actor, having written two books about your grandfather and having played him on stage in the play Give 'Em Hell, Harry. The famous actor James Whitmore originated that role in 1975, and you've played the role 3 years ago, beginning in 2017. First, tell us what it was like stepping into the shoes of your grandfather.
Weirdest retirement plan ever. I saw the play years ago. I saw the film of James Whitmore do it on an airplane with my mother. She took a nap because she'd seen the movie, so I watched it. And I liked the show. I thought Whitmore was excellent, but it never occurred to me to take on the role until I, giving speeches about my grandfather, as I began to get older, people at the end of speeches would tell me that I was beginning to look like my grandfather. So the light bulb went off. And friends of mine in Florida, Gary and Nancy Katz, encouraged me to look into this. And a friend of mine in Wilmington, North Carolina, where we originated the show, Tony Rivenbark, jumped on it and said, "Yes, you're coming, you're doing it." And that's how it started in 2017. I have more fun with it now than I did at the beginning. In the beginning, I was terrified because I wanted to get it right. I listened to hours and hours of his voice on tape, courtesy of the Truman Library archives. Looked at movies, watched newsreels, anything I could see to get his mannerisms, just to remind myself of what he'd been like as a younger man. But now, we haven't been doing any shows this year, but it's, you know, the more I do it, the more I enjoy it. It's a lot of fun.
And can we ask you tonight to, for a few moments, step back into that role and share
sure.
with us a segment of Give 'Em Hell, Harry?
Sure. This is a bit from early on in the show, and because I've got COVID hair, I'll just sort of push that back out of the way. We can't do the white hair, so I'll get rid of it with a hat and get the glasses on here. Early in the show, when he's talking to the audience about the difference between becoming president and then how he does things. Now, I never saw myself as president. I was just in the right place at the wrong damn time. Lots of folks could do a better job, but it became mine to do, and as long as you put me here, you'll get the best I've got. I've always considered myself an ordinary man, I don't have any special personal endowments, but I don't waste my time worrying about what I don't have. I just try to do the best with what I do have. I've always thought it was more important to get something said and done and stop worrying about how you're going to do it or say it. And I don't waste my time comparing myself to other men either. All men do things differently. I don't compare myself to Franklin Roosevelt or Winston Churchill. There's no reason to do that. But I'll give you an example. I once ran into the great all-time American snob, the Lady Astor. Some of you may have heard of her. She's a transplanted Virginian, developed a British accent so thick even the British can't understand her, let alone stand her. Well, I ran into the great lady at a dinner party down in Richmond, Virginia, and she said some very unkind things about my Missouri accent. Well, I cut her short. I said, at least my accent comes naturally. Now, Winston Churchill does things a little differently. He ran into the great lady at a dinner party in London, and she was seated next to the prime minister and undertook to give him a lecture. She said, Winston, I believe you're quite drunk. And Churchill looked at her and said, Madam, you are absolutely right. I am quite drunk. You, on the other hand, are unbelievably ugly. And in the morning, I am no doubt going to be sober.
Thank you so much. when the dust settles from this pandemic, will you be taking the show on the road again?
I hope so. I still have one show scheduled, Jefferson City, Missouri, for four shows at the beginning of November. So we'll see if that holds. But who knows? My wife, my wife loves the end of that show, and so do I. When my grandfather says to the audience, the time has come for me to leave this office, this job, this honor that you've bestowed on me. Benjamin Franklin dealt with this exact moment. He said that in a free society, the rulers are the servants, and the people are their superiors and sovereigns. Therefore, to return to that role is not to demote them, but to promote them. My promotion is to be one of you. It's a nice ending to the show.
It's a beautiful ending. It speaks so highly of him. And let me extend this invitation now. When the dust settles and the opportunity presents itself, come perform the program at the National Press Club. We would love to have you
come and do
that.
No piano playing, though.
we'll come back to that. We'll come back to that in a few minutes. Kurt Graham, it's said that the presidential libraries reflect the personality of the presidents that they represent. President Truman is remembered, as you've said, as a small-town, self-made, hard-working man who was extraordinarily ordinary. He became a decisive leader, took full responsibility for his actions. It sounds like you feel that the Truman Library is reflective of these and perhaps other characteristics of President Truman.
Well, I think it very much is. And one of the things I can point to in that is that Harry Truman was the first president to be able to build his library as a post-presidential project. The system was begun by Franklin Roosevelt. You remember that in those days, a president's papers were personal property. Roosevelt and Truman and Ike, they could have just burned their papers had they wanted to. And it wasn't until the post-Watergate era that the Presidential Records Act was passed, and it applies to Reagan forward, that those libraries make it very clear, that the law makes it very clear, that the more modern administrations, their papers, their memos, their executive orders, their tweets are all the property of the people. And they will be archived and kept for future generations. Truman and Roosevelt and others had the vision to want to preserve those papers. And so Truman comes back to Independence and he builds this library. He helps design it. He helps raise the money for it. A whopping $1.6 million, as I remember. And we're doing a $25 million renovation as we speak. It's amazing to think if he'd have just, raised another $1 million in 1957 and put that in the bank, can you imagine where our institute would be today? But nevertheless, Harry Truman did not think in those terms. He thought about just getting the building built. It reflects his personality. It's humble. It's low profile. He had a working office in this building. He came here 6 days a week. You know, he could have built this library anywhere. He had offers for property in California, Southern California. I remind my colleagues from time to time, we could have had palm trees and good weather year round, but we're here in Independence, Missouri, which Truman felt was the center of the universe. And he would come in on those days, and a couple of things, he would answer the phone on the weekends because there were no staff around. You know, presidents didn't have staffs and even Secret Service protection at that time. So he was just an ordinary citizen. He just walked to work or drove his car and parked and came in the building, and he would answer the phone on Saturdays. You know, they would ask, well, what are your hours? How much does it cost? I mean, all those kinds of things, that he would just be his own receptionist. But he always used to tell his secretary during the week, if you see a busload of kids pull up, herd them into the auditorium and come and get me. And I have people come up to me all the time, older people now, obviously, but they'll say, you know, when I was in third grade, Harry Truman came out and sat on the edge of that stage and dangled his legs over the edge of that auditorium, which is exactly what it was when he was here, and spoke to us about the importance of the presidency, about the importance of government, about why it works the way it does, about, you know, our civic education and why we should get involved and why we should care. And I think that this institution, the building, our programs, our exhibits, everything we do, everything I do on a daily basis, I try to embody that spirit of what Truman wanted this place to be. He wanted it to be a place of education, a place of learning. He did not envision this as a shrine to himself. He would be mortified to think of the degree to which we've made this new exhibit about him. That was never his purpose. He did not intend to be the centerpiece. But in a way, it isn't about him. It's about us. It's about what our society needs and wants. And frankly, there is no better vehicle to get to what we need or want right now than Harry Truman, because Harry Truman is a model of leadership. And that's what people on both sides of the aisle, and I give a lot of tours to a lot of very prominent people, and whether they're from the far right or the far left or anywhere in between, they'll always utter something along the lines of, would to God that we had another Harry Truman. And so that legacy, I feel, is just the embodiment. This institution is the embodiment of that legacy. And we owe him, and more importantly, we owe ourselves and our society a chance to reflect on that legacy and remind ourselves what real leadership looks like.
He became president at an incredibly difficult time for America and the world, and he had huge shoes to fill following the death of Franklin Roosevelt. He made a lot of tough decisions. We've talked about a lot of them. He initiated the types of plans that are lasting to this day. Over the course of time, his popularity has risen, and it seems to still be rising. Do you attribute that to some of the things that you just said about it? Are there specific reasons why you think his popularity continues to rise? Kurt, I'll ask you that first.
Yeah, I do. I think there are several reasons. You know, beginning 25 plus years ago, David McCullough's masterful biography of Truman really sort of shined the light on Truman in a big way for the first time. Truman left office, as you know, largely because of the Korean conflict, but he left office with the lowest poll numbers ever recorded. And so he just kind of, aw shucks, I did my best, go back to Missouri, and, you know, just, I mean, I did what I thought I could do. And he would be surprised today to find himself listed consistently as one of the fifth or sixth most important, influential, and effective presidents we've ever had, typically behind Washington, Lincoln, and the two Roosevelts. That would be surprising to him, I think, to hear that kind of ranking today. But the other thing I think that really has made a difference in the Truman legacy, as I mentioned, this legacy of leadership, the idea that we hunger and we yearn for real leaders and to know what real leadership looks like. But, you know, when he left office because of the Korean conflict, it took another decade or two before the reality of Johnson being mired down in the quagmire of Vietnam. The stalemate in Korea looked weak at the time. But when we got caught up in Vietnam, people started to realize, you know, maybe there is something worse than a stalemate in Asia. You can actually lose. And I think the reality of that made people reconsider, you know, maybe this Harry Truman guy, maybe he was wise not to pull China into World War III. Having fought in World War I and having ended World War II, Truman wasn't about to start World War III. He could have bombed his way to a third term, I'm convinced of that. But he opted to take another path. And he sort of took it on the chin for a long time, really throughout the rest of his life. He did not die knowing of the popularity that has come to him since. But I think as we look back and we see, no, there was something about the way he handled that conflict and the way he handled civilian supremacy of the armed forces and the way he handled the United Nations that we say, no, that man was wise. He was careful. He was deliberate. He was decisive. I always say that about Harry Truman. He didn't just make a lot of decisions. He was decisive. And there's a difference. And I think that I think people respect that. And I think that's why his stock is going up. I mean, it's a good time to buy Truman stock, by the way.
Clifton, do you want to add anything to that on his legacy and his popularity rising?
Yeah, as Kurt was talking, as a 15-year-old, he died December 26th, 1972. That following spring, I was at school. And up to that point, it had been cool to be Harry Truman's grandson, but as I said, my parents downplayed it. And as you've both been talking about, his role in the world, his role in history, was not what it is now. He had the lowest approval ratings when he left office. So it was great to be Harry Truman's grandson, but it was not a big deal. And one afternoon that spring of 1973, one of the kids in the dorm called me back to his room, I mean, yelling, screaming, "Come back here. You need to listen to this." And I ran into his room and he cranked the volume on his stereo, and it was the band Chicago playing "America Needs You," Harry Truman. A rock band was singing about my grandfather. And that for me was the turning point. People started to recognize my name, which was weird to me. But at that point was when his star started to rise. Grandpa predicted it. He said, no president gets a fair shake historically until at least 20 years after he's left office. So, but that's when it started to change noticeably for the family, for his grandchildren.
Okay, so speaking of music, we can't end this wonderful interview without going back to the most famous photograph ever taken here at the Press Club of then Vice President Truman playing the upright piano with the model and movie actress Lauren Bacall draped across the top of it, both happily gazing at each other. It happened on a Saturday at a canteen here at the club, and we talked about those earlier. We understand that that Bess Truman was not too happy about that photo, which of course was splashed over newspapers across the country and was on the cover of Life magazine. What can you tell us about the photo and its aftermath in the Truman family?
That, well, you said it, my grandmother. And Grandpa, I will argue with you about that he was not gazing happily at Lauren Bacall. She was gazing down at him. As you said, it was a stunt that her press agent or agent put her up to and hoisted her up on the piano. Grandpa had been grinning from ear to ear prior to that photograph being taken. And the smile has dimmed considerably because he knows who's going to see this. And sure enough, when he went home that evening, my grandmother was stonily silent for a while and then said very quietly, "I don't think you should play the piano in public anymore." And I don't think he did. He was a very, very accomplished classical pianist. In fact, he himself famously once said, if it hadn't been for politics, he'd have wound up piano player in a whorehouse. And really, there's hardly any difference.
You know, our club historian and former president, Gil Klein, shared with me that 15 years later, when Mr. Truman made a post-presidential visit back here to the National Press Club. He said how wonderful it was to be back at the club, even though, and I'm quoting here, some smart press fellow had caused me a hell of a lot of trouble at home. So certainly in keeping with what you said. Let me ask a few questions here that have come in from those watching the program tonight. National Press Club member Nancy Hart, with hindsight and in light of helping to bring about the Japanese surrender and of his career service, did President Truman have any afterthoughts about eventually relieving General MacArthur of his military duties in the 1950s? Kurt, let me toss that one to you first.
Well, you know, MacArthur is a big hero. I mean, he's the one who accepts the surrender on the deck of the Missouri, you know. So I mean, he's and even once he gets in, and of course, here's what goes on. Here's my interpretation of what happens to MacArthur and Truman. MacArthur goes on in the post-war world to live basically as the emperor of Japan. I mean, he stays in Asia. He is in charge of all of that that's going on over there. Truman and his advisors are all still very Eurocentric in as they start to develop Cold War strategies and all those kinds of things. They're thinking about, you know, Eastern Europe, Western Europe. They have a very Eurocentric view of the world. MacArthur has a very Asian-centric view of the world. But, and I think Truman would have been fine with that. I think he respected MacArthur. Even in Korea, when MacArthur was starting to become a little bit of a thorn in his side, he still would compliment the general on some very bold moves that he made militarily, strategically, and you know, the invasion and whatnot that have gone very well. But there came a point when MacArthur lost sight of a very important constitutional principle in the United States, and that is the civilian supremacy of the armed forces, that it is wisely civilian elected leaders, the people, the representatives of the people, who make those kinds of decisions, not career military people. And so MacArthur, I think, lost sight of that, and Truman gave him a lot of slack, and you know, Truman was not quick-tempered or quick to, you know, cut the guy off at the knees or whatever. I think he tried to make it work for as long as he possibly could. Now afterwards, I think he grumbled, I should have done that a long time ago. But MacArthur comes home to a hero's welcome, and the Republican Congress, in an effort to help embarrass Mr. Truman, allow him to give this great speech to the Congress where MacArthur says, "Old soldiers never die, they just fade away." Well, unfortunately, MacArthur didn't know well enough to fade away, and he overreached and became somewhat discredited. And I think, again, you ask why Harry Truman's stock is rising. I think because they can look back at a situation like that and realize that he did the right thing. He underscored an important constitutional principle that needed to be reinforced. Now, I know there are fans of MacArthur out there. I'm not trying to dissuade anyone of the greatness of the general, but he did step out of line. And it was up to Harry Truman to correct him, and that's exactly what he did.
Clifton, did you want to add anything to that?
Just quickly, never let it be said that the United States military doesn't have a sense of humor. When I was at the War College in Leavenworth a few years ago, they were inducting Grandpa. Kurt, did you go on that trip? Can't remember.
Oh, yeah, you spoke there. Yeah. I remember it well.
Right. We went, they inducted my grandfather into the Hall of Fame at the War College at Leavenworth, because he trained with the Missouri National Guard at Leavenworth in 1923.
Right.
And prior to the ceremony and my acceptance speech on behalf of the family, they did a quick television interview, and the War College keeps a ceremonial office for each of the nation's five-star generals. And of course, when they set me up to do the interview, one of them stood next to me real close and he said, "Guess where you are?" And I said, "What do you mean?" He said, "You're in MacArthur's office." So they put me in the general's office to do the interview. So again, the duality, as Kurt was saying, that General MacArthur was a great leader, a great general, but he stepped out of line. And I got the feeling that at Leavenworth, they understood both sides.
Thank you both for those answers. And we have a question which we touched on earlier, but let me ask it. It's submitted by National Press Club member Christopher Woody. In the 8 years President Truman held office after the war, What role did he want the U.S. to play in the world, and how did he use its power and stature to achieve it? We've talked about some of those things, but Kurt, let me ask you if you want to expand on that.
Sure. Well, I think just the kind of quick answer to that is it's interesting to think about how things have changed in our own time. And these things come back, they're relevant again, because in those days, the Republican Party, Senator Robert Taft, Vandenberg, certainly even Charles Lindbergh, not in office, but, you know, a very prominent American who had very isolationist tendencies. The Republican Party was very much about America being just closed off to itself, and we don't need the rest of the world, we don't need to be a part of that. Truman, I mean, and Roosevelt before him, for sure, by putting us on the world stage in that way, but there would be no American century had there been no Harry Truman. The idea that America was going to play a role in the world, and not just a military policing role, but think about the effect of the Marshall Plan. Think about that level of aid. I mean, I want to say it was over 10% of our GDP at the time that went into rebuilding Europe. And not just our friends, not just our allies, rebuilding the world. And, you know, Truman was once asked, what do you do with a vanquished foe? And he said, you welcome them into the family of nations. And that's exactly what he set out to do. So no, I think not just the map of the world is different, but America's role on that stage owes everything to the attitude that Truman took and articulated through the Truman Doctrine, that we'll stand with our friends. NATO is an embodiment of that spirit, of that thinking. And I have, just as a quick aside, if we've got just a minute, that I have had that conversation in our galleries with very prominent people. One comes to mind is the ambassador from South Korea, who spoke to me about how he credits Harry Truman and Winston Churchill with putting in place the scaffolding, the structure that has brought more peace and more prosperity to more people in the world than at any other comparable time in history. The last 70 years, I know we've had famine, I know we've had war, but nothing like what has been known in the past. And he credits Harry Truman with bringing that prosperity, not just to Western Europe and the United States, but to Asia and Latin America and Africa, and all parts of the world have benefited from the role that America played because of Harry Truman. Now, I know that's being questioned again. I know this question of globalism versus isolationism, and again, that's a political discussion that I'm not going to get into, but I will tell you that it was put together very carefully. And if it is to be dismantled, I hope the same thought and care is being given to that step as was given to its initiation.
Thank you very much. And Clifton, did you want to add anything to that answer?
No, I think Kurt covered that beautifully.
Great. We're almost out of time. What I'd like to do is come back to what happened 75 years ago today when the Japanese surrender was signed, ending World War II. Clifton, do we have a sense of what your grandfather's thoughts were that day? Did he talk about it in subsequent years? What did he do that day?
That's a very good question, Mike. I do not know.
Okay.
I think that sometimes the actual day, September 2nd, mm-hmm. as far as my grandfather's concerned, gets kind of lost. What he was doing. I assume that he was at his desk working, which is where you usually find him. But that also it gets a little overshadowed by the end of the war in Europe, which occurred on his birthday, May 8th. So he always said, and it's the lighter, more well-known line. He said it was the best birthday present he'd ever gotten. Sure. And I assume.
And certainly the end of the war with the bombs, I mean, for Harry Truman, the war ended earlier in August. I mean, the signing is significant, and that's certainly a big moment, and we don't want to detract from that moment. But I don't either recall, I mean, I don't know what Truman did on that particular day to commemorate that. I'm sure it was important to him, and I'm sure he appreciated what happened. But it was met by Truman just like it was met by most Americans, with incredible relief that this time was behind us, and that he could now get on to governing, which is what he did for the next 7.5 years.
Our thanks to Clifton Truman Daniel and Dr. Kurt Graham. We're honored to present each of you with a National Press Club coffee mug. We will send them out to you, along with our very sincere hope that you will join us again in person in the very near future. Great good luck, and again, thank you both so much.
Thanks, Mike. Thanks. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Our thanks to Commander Jim Noone and the members of the American Legion Post 20, to former National Press Club President Gil Klein, our producer tonight, Laura Coker, and to our wonderful National Press Club team behind the scenes here in the Broadcast Operations Center. We thank all the members and guests for your questions and for joining us. We'd like to close tonight's program by paying tribute to the sacrifices made by Americans across the country during World War II, those who served and those who lost their lives. We are honored to present, courtesy of the newspaper of the Armed Forces, Stars and Stripes, this recording of Taps at the World War II Memorial. Be well, stay safe, have a good evening, and tonight we say, God bless America.